Welcome back to part 5 of pain throughout the organ systems. And we're going to talk about female heart attack symptoms. There are certainly similarities between symptoms of a heart attack between males and females, but it's important to be aware of some specific differences because we don't want to miss this major problem. I suggest that you click on this link before going any further to learn a bit more about female myocardial infarction symptoms. It's a pretty good YouTube video. As shown on these drawings, there are some signs and symptoms that indicate a possibility of a heart attack in both men and women. Notice the nausea slash vomiting, jaw pain, and back pain in a female versus the chest discomfort, arm pain, and shortness of breath typically found in a male suffering from a heart attack. Also notice that people don't always follow rules, so there's definitely some overlap between symptoms of males and females. The other drawing to the right is some common problems that mimic symptoms of a heart attack. These would be in our differential diagnosis. Of course, we all know that we look for a heart attack with the easy-to-do EKG, but the words STEMI and non-STEMI may be new to you. The ST stands for the two segments of the EKG, S and T segments. The rest of the STEMI means elevation myocardial infarction. So we have an ST elevated and a non-ST elevated MI heart attack. Which do you think is worse? Would this be a good time to learn what a normal ECG looks like? It's definitely something you should know because you have to be able to distinguish between normal, a STEMI, and a non-STEMI heart attack, as well as some electrolyte deficient ECGs. This might be a good place to pause and look up a normal ECG. By the way, notice how I use EKG and ECG synonymously. They are the same thing, but one way's from German origin. Does this make sense to you that the blood pressure decreases initially when having a heart attack? I hope so. Think about that for a second. When the heart isn't pumping correctly, the blood isn't coming out as good as it should, so of course the pressure will be less. Less flow equals less pressure. But as our sympathetic nervous system reacts to the decreased blood pressure, it's going to signal the heart rate, chronotrophy, chrono, like watch, and BP, blood pressure, inotrophy, to increase to restore blood flow and oxygen. Fair enough? Also, this might be a good place to review heart sounds. The lub-dub sounds that you hear with a stethoscope are just valves closing. You should be pretty familiar with those from earlier A&P classes, and I'm just saying that they aren't going to sound normal when having a heart attack. Duh. Also, think about this for a bit. Since blood flows from the right side of the heart to the lungs and then to the left side of the heart, if the left side of the heart is infarcting, unless otherwise stated we assume that the heart attack is on the left heart, then we'll get a backup of blood into the lungs. Well, we can hear that, and it sounds like you might expect when something's full of liquid. If you thump on it with your hand, it'll sound dull. Whatever that means. It's full. Inspiratory crackles just means that it sounds like there's water crackling when the patient breathes inward, which is pretty much true. Water, blood, exudate, whatever, is leaking into spaces where it shouldn't be at. Let's get back to lab tests for a minute. Now, we haven't mentioned the troponins yet, so let's do that. Troponin I and troponin T are both found in heart muscle and therefore are specific for diagnosing a heart attack. They're not normally found in the blood at all. When an MI happens, these enzymes are released into the blood from the dying heart and stay there for about 2 weeks. The little chart with the heart on it in a couple of slides ahead just says 1 week, but it's actually about 14 days. That's how the doctor can sometimes tell that they had a heart attack within the last week or two. let me repeat that. The enzymes are released from the dying cells into the blood. Sound familiar? That's a mechanism of cell damage, isn't it? See how this all ties together? It's important for you to know that those mechanisms, because somewhere along the line, someone figured out and invented a blood test that we use every day to diagnose a heart attack. So please do your best to completely understand this stuff. Trust me, it'll help you in the long run. Who knows, it might even help you win a Nobel Prize someday. Don't forget how to pronounce my name in your acceptance speech, by the way. Anyway, lactate dehydrogenase is another non-specific enzyme that just indicates that there has been some cell damage somewhere in the body. There are so many different reasons that LDH is elevated. I'm not going to go into them here. I'll just say that LDH levels doubles about 3 days after an MI, and it takes about a week to go back to normal levels. Creatine phosphokinase, CPK or CPKMB myocardial bound, used to be the enzyme of choice before the troponins came along. It's found in heart muscle. It's a little less specific for MI and shows up in the blood about 6 hours after a heart attack and only lasts in the blood for about 2 days. Incidentally, other isoenzyme forms of CPK are CPKBB, found in the brain, and CPKMM in skeletal muscle. This last one, myoglobin, lasts about a day in the blood and just tells us that some muscle tissue is breaking down somewhere. So it's not specific for cardiac. Big one is a troponins, I and T. This slide is for your review. Take a minute and see what you can remember. What are the signs and symptoms you're looking for? What are the lab tests that you would run? I'm sorry, I'm talking about the wrong slide. This slide's kind of cool, mostly because it was made by a student, but it shows the overall picture of a lot of enzymes right here, before, during, and after a heart attack. I don't think there's anything on here that we didn't already talk about, but feel free to pause this and check it out. By the way, this is the kind of graph that shows up on the MCAT, the Medical College Admissions Test, this one right here. It would have a question that goes on forever. The final question would be something like, based on the information on the graph and from the passage, when did this patient have a myocardial infarction? So you have to go back to the hour since you had an MI and which of the enzymes are peaked. Okay, this slide is for your review. Take a minute and see what you can remember. What are the signs and symptoms you're looking for? What are the lab tests that you would run? These last bits of slides are fully illustrated drawings and pictures of coronary artery occlusion and surgical bypass and grafting. Check them out, they're pretty cool. So I'll be quiet for a second and let you look at these.
Just take some time. Let me try.